Fukushima and the Three Mile Island accidents are among some of the worst nuclear reactor accidents in our history. But why did they happen? Today I'm going to explain the physics and implement that in the simulation. We'll play around with the simulation and get an understanding of what happened in the Fukushima accident and in the Three Mile Island accident. A lot of you requested this video, so this one is for you. So this video is part 2 of the Chernobyl accident video. In the Chernobyl accident video, I introduced one nuclear concept at a time and implemented that in a simulation. I will do an extremely fast refresher if you didn't watch it, but I really recommend watching that video first. If you're up to speed already, just skip to the timestamp shown on the screen. So we set a uranium-235 nuclei to be a big blue circle. We set the neutron to be a dark gray smaller circle. These two can interact and fission. We set all non-uranium-235 elements to be a light gray color. So these elements could be another non-fissile uranium isotope or the daughter products of the fission reaction. All light gray color will have some random chance to undergo spontaneous neutron emission, just sending out neutrons randomly. Used up, uranium-235 will be replaced magically. You will always have around 5% concentration of uranium-235. We have control rods that absorb neutrons. We have water that can absorb neutrons, but the water can also heat up and evaporate. Fast neutrons indicated with a white dot move too fast for interaction and do not cause a fission. We have moderators that upon collision with the fast neutrons eat some kinetic energy and can cause fission again. With all of these properties, we can simulate the Chernobyl graphite RBMK reactor like this. If all of that was confusing or was too quick, go see the Chernobyl video and come back. Introducing water-based moderators. The graphite moderator reactor RBMK is not the focus of today. Instead, we'll talk about a much, much more safe reactor, one that does not use graphite moderators. So let's throw out the graphite moderators and run the simulation. The control rods keep retracting, but we can clearly see we are in desperate need of some moderation, since all released neutrons are moving too fast and therefore the interaction probability is extremely low. In the video about Chernobyl, I actually lied a bit. Oh, simplified the model. Sorry. The lie was, water is also a moderator, and a great one actually. These water-based reactors with a negative void coefficient instead of a positive one are much, much more safe. So let's add that property to the water. So now the water will not only randomly absorb neutrons, heat up, it will also continually slow, i.e. moderate, fast neutrons when they are inside the water, until they reach the thermal speed and the neutron can stimulate fission again. So let's see this moderation of water in the reactor, where we this time retract control rods and insert them again to try and reach around 40 neutrons inside the reactor. I count the neutrons up here. So we can see water is a possible choice as a moderator, and actually almost all nuclear power plants use it today. But the water I've shown you in the simulation, is it heavy water or light water? Heavy versus light water. Just a quick side note, I'm guessing you will wonder, am I talking about heavy or light water? Light water is what comes out of your water tap, H2O. Two hydrogen nuclei and an oxygen nuclei bound together. I didn't bother drawing the electrons because they play no role in a nuclear reaction. So the two hydrogen nuclei are really just two protons. With heavy water, these two hydrogen nuclei will both have a neutron bound to the nucleus, called deuterium. Both types of water are excellent moderators, but heavy water won't absorb neutrons as much as light water. Using light water is more dangerous because it will absorb more neutrons, causing the need for higher enriched nuclear fuel and a higher neutron density in the reactor. However, light water is cheap. So to answer the question, are we using heavy or light water? Well, neither, since I'm just manually typing in some random absorption chance that I chose. It doesn't have anything to do with neither light nor heavy water. I'll now try to recreate a terrible nuclear accident by completely retracting the control rods. But, as you can see, the reactor has a negative void coefficient. As the reactivity goes up, more water evaporates. As more water evaporates, the more the reactor loses its ability to moderate neutrons, reactivity goes down. This is an example of passive nuclear safety, where a nuclear reactor will try and shut itself off in case something spirals out of control. And so, water-based moderator reactors operate safely without any issues ever, and everyone lived happy with free energy without any problems at all.
Frank, it was an accident at the Three Mile Island nuclear power plant.
Oh.
To Japan now, where over a million tons of wastewater from the Fukushima nuclear power plant has begun to be released into the Pacific Ocean.
Oops. Okay, so not quite, unfortunately. Even though this passive cooling should take care of any problems, we will see what went wrong. Let's start by comparing the accidents. Both were light water moderator reactors that had this negative void coefficient I showed you. But one was a boiling type and another was a pressure reactor. There were zero deaths in both accidents, though some heightened cancer rates for some. Only a small amount of radioactivity fallout was released, about 7% of what released during the Chernobyl accident combined. Most of the fallout was released gradually, resulting in no cases of acute radiation poisoning. From a physics standpoint, these accidents are quite similar. So I will use this simulation and explain what went wrong. Both accidents, Fukushima and Three Mile Island, at the same time. But before I'm able to do that, I need to introduce another nuclear physics concept, nuclear decay heat. After fission, the daughter products are still radioactive and will continue to release secondary neutrons, alpha particles, beta particles, and gamma rays. This will continue until the nuclei reach a stable isotope. As a better example, if we look at the table of nuclei here, where the color depicts what kind of random decay an element will undergo, but black is stable and the element won't change. If you look at the fission uranium-235, in a fission reaction, common elements are barium and krypton, and of course, three neutrons. Barium and krypton is still radioactive and will continue to send out highly energetic particles until it has changed itself into a stable nuclei. This is called decay heat. Of course, this is just one of the two daughter products, and the decay path is not deterministic. Let's simplify the radioactive products the fission releases. Let's denote gamma rays, alpha particles, and beta particles, all as this purple particle. Let's add this decay heat property to the simulation. After a nucleus has fissioned and released three neutrons, it will now become radioactive. I'll mark that with a purple border. Let's just set the radioactive part to be able to release 10 particles, alpha, beta, and gamma rays, at random time. Then it will be stable again, marked with just a light gray color, as before. So let's use simulation and see what went wrong. Timeline, accident. Event 0. Both reactors are running stable and on full power. Before the accident, both reactors were running perfectly fine. I'll play the simulation around a minute's time so you can get a feeling of this heat decay property. I added the total number of particles, including the purple particles from the secondary decays, up here. These purple particles that represent a radioactive decay doesn't really influence the nuclear reactor. The only thing it does is it's heating up the core. Event 1. Something is wrong. In both reactors, they detected something was wrong. Seismic measurements scrammed the Fukushima power plant. In the Three Mile Island, a valve malfunctioned and caused a loss in water pressure, which scrammed the reactor. To reflect this, in the simulation you can see here, I'm also scramming the reactor. Scram here, by the way, only takes around 3 seconds, but in the RBMK Chernobyl reactor, it took 20 seconds. But if the reactor successfully were stopped, what went wrong then? Event 2, loss of cooling. To reflect this in the simulation, let's disable water cooling. In Fukushima, the backup diesel generators was destroyed by the tsunami. In Three Mile Island, a valve was mistakenly left open and emergency cooling systems was mistakenly turned off. These particles that caused decay heat is of course not stimulated and triggered by neutrons, but simply the nucleons deciding to decay according to the half-life. Therefore, control rods can't do anything, leaving only the coolant water to keep this decay heat in check. But as mentioned, the coolant water was lost. Decay heat accounts for up to 7% of the total energy production of a reactor, so it's an insane amount of power to have stuck inside a small volume. If you can't cool down this decay heat, the reactor will melt together with its fuel, control rods and other material, and it's called corium. Without cooling this corium, it will continue getting hotter and hotter until it melts whatever container you have it in. Event 3, meltdown. Okay, it looks quite lame in my simulation, so I didn't bother including it. Both reactors had a partial meltdown. Just imagine all the material clumping together into an extremely hot, lava-like mass capable of melting anything. Fortunately, responders acted quickly, and a large containment building were able to hold most back of the radiation. However, the remaining water inside the reactor posed a risk of forming a hydrogen gas, which could lead to an explosion and release more radioactive material into the nature. This unfortunately happened in the Fukushima disaster. Event 4. Is that it? Later, they got the water cooling under control in both reactors and they were able to remove most nuclear fuel. After the meltdowns, efforts to stabilize both reactors were successful. At Three Mile Island, the situation was brought under control within days and the reactor was permanently shut down. The containment structure prevented any significant release of radiation to the surrounding environment. At Fukushima, the response was more complex and took longer due to the extent damage from the tsunami. Multiple reactors were eventually stabilized and cooled, but the Fukushima plant was permanently decommissioned. Thanks to the generous Patreon supporters for helping sponsoring this video, and thanks to the one-time donation on Ko-fi. These people tipped since the last video. Consider supporting these videos if you would also like them to be ad-free in the future. Alright, so that's the physics of both accidents. Obviously, again, I skipped tons of details, but kept the essential physics of both accidents. Thank you for watching.